What's up, y'all? It's Anthony D. Mays, your favorite straight out of Compton engineer and nerd with an attitude. All right, so today we're going to talk about the six steps. This is the strategy that I teach all of my clients, all of my students around how to tackle coding interviews. If you can do these six things, you will find your ability to conquer problems that you haven't seen before just goes through the roof. So we're going to talk about those steps one by one. And before we get started, if you enjoyed this content, make sure to like and subscribe and let's talk about it. Step one, repeat the question. Anytime you're working on a coding problem, it's very important for you to understand the problem that you need to solve. And that begins by just having a clear statement of the problem. Whether you're practicing by yourself or whether you're practicing with other people, restate the problem out loud, preferably in your own words. This does three things for you. It buys you time to think. Often when you're hearing a coding problem, you don't exactly know what to do right away. And that's by design, that's okay. What's important for you is to just begin the process of talking through the problem and what you need to do. And you can start just by repeating the question out loud in your own words. The second thing this does for you is if there are any communication issues, you don't wanna get hung up having a wrong impression of the problem because you didn't hear a word correctly or you missed an important detail. So by repeating the question back, it gives your interviewer an opportunity to correct any early misunderstanding that you might have about the problem. It's always tragic when someone goes to solve a problem, but they are solving for the wrong constraint. You don't want that to be you. By repeating the question, you give the interviewer an opportunity very early on to interact with you and provide you feedback that's designed to help you along the way. Third thing, if you are an auditory learner, that is, if you learn best by hearing, sometimes just repeating the question out loud in your own voice helps you to think about that problem differently. You can almost think about it like rubber duck debugging, which is super useful if you haven't tried it before. If you've ever been the kind of person to ask somebody a question and before you even get done asking, you're already thinking about the problem differently and have a solution in mind, this step is for you. Just by repeating the question, sometimes it just causes your brain to think about the problem differently and helps you to tap into techniques that can help you understand that problem better. Step number two, ask clarifying questions. There's a couple of things that you want to do in this step. First things first is you just want to check any assumptions that you have. So you should either explicitly state them or ask the question. As I've said in a previous video, this is one of the reasons why you study algorithms, data structures in Big O, because the kinds of questions that you ask are designed to help identify the set of tools that are gonna be the most helpful or eliminate the tools that aren't gonna be as helpful to you. If you understand your algorithms and data structures in Big O pretty well, or just generally your coding tools, that will help you to know what kinds of questions that you should ask. As you're practicing for coding interviews, you should practice asking good questions and knowing what questions are going to be relevant for helping you to solve the problem and which ones aren't. Don't be surprised if you ask a question and your interviewer turns it around back on you to get your thoughts. It's not that they won't eventually answer your question, but they just want to see how you think about things and it can be a useful interaction. Maybe you're thinking about a specific method and the interviewer just wants to know why you picked that one versus a different one. I'm going to do a video on questions that you should be asking in the interview, so make sure to subscribe so that you can get that when it comes out. Step number three, work through examples. I can't tell you how important it is for you to think about some example inputs using some real data and the corresponding outputs for those inputs. It does a couple of things for you. Number one, it helps you to understand the shape of the input data and helps you to also discern what the output should look like. If you go through this process, you might come up with additional questions that you can be asking about how the input turns into the output, because ultimately that's the code that you have to write. Think about the inputs and the corresponding outputs. If you're used to coming up with test cases, this is a great way for you to showcase that you have a good, like, test-driven mindset. Just like you would come up with test cases for code, identifying your inputs and outputs are kind of like identifying test cases that you can use later on in the problem-solving process. It also helps to clearly communicate things that you have affirmed as you have checked your assumptions and asked questions. One of the great things about using examples is that if you show your interviewer an example that isn't valid or that isn't correct, it gives your interviewer an opportunity to correct any misunderstanding that you have early on before you start to code. There are so many people who have been in interviews who start coding right away as soon as they hear the problem, and it's always the wrong move 99% of the time. What you have to do is make sure that you have a good understanding of the problem. And one of the ways that you do that is by working through examples to make sure that you are clear and that your interviewer is clear on your understanding of the problem. People who work through examples tend to do better, in my experience, in the interview overall, because they show that they have a really good understanding of the problem, and I'm able to help them as an interviewer to correct any misunderstanding that they might have. Okay, fourth thing that you should do, brainstorm. By brainstorm, I mean think of multiple solutions, not just one. I think it can be a mistake to come up with just a naive solution and then immediately get into code. There are some problem-solving strategies like Reacto or maybe like Umpire that would encourage you to just go with the first idea that you have. But I'm a big fan of thinking of two or three different ways that you can solve the problem. And the reason why this is helpful is that if I, as your interviewer, know that there are two or three ways that you're thinking about solving the problem, I can push you in a specific direction to help you do better in the long run. And it's not necessarily that you aren't going to start with the brute force solution. It's that by putting two or three options on the table, you're showing me that you're thinking about how to get to the optimal solution. Which also reminds me, you need to be asking yourself, what's the best that I can do in this problem? So it's important to know, like, what version of optimality you're going for. Are you going for the fastest code, maybe from a big O time complexity perspective? Are you going for the most efficient code from a space complexity perspective? Are you going for the code that you can implement the fastest? You need to talk about this with your interviewer to make sure that you're on the same page with regards to what optimal means. But once that's defined, then as you start brainstorming different strategies, you can figure out why one strategy might be better than another one based upon how you've defined optimal. Now, in many coding interviews, big O, time complexity or space complexity, is the way that we're going to measure optimality. So be prepared to understand for any solution what the big O might be for that. Now, again, it's what it might be. You don't have to know whether a solution is actually going to work. Just brainstorming and expressing your ideas out loud will give your interviewer ammunition to then help you to go in one specific direction or another. Because remember, the interviewer already knows what answers they're expecting. They know what the best answer is. They know what the worst answer is. They know what everything is in between, generally speaking, because they've probably done the question several times with several candidates. If you can show them that you're going in the right direction, which is the most important thing, then brainstorming will be a very effective help for you before you start writing code. There have been times when I was tempted to do where I had a naive solution that would have worked, but because I had the conversation with the interviewer, I was able to do the more optimal solution as my first approach and save time in the long run getting an answer that was going to help me get hired. Now, if you get stuck trying to figure out how to improve on a naive solution, that's fine. You've got a couple of choices. If all you can do is think of a naive solution, then by all means, go and implement that. Move on to the next step. That way you don't lose too much time trying to think up better ways of solving this. Sometimes you need to actually implement your solution before you can clearly see the ways in which you would change that to get to a better solution. But one thing that you can do to get better at improving a naive solution is to remember the space-time trade-off principle. Let's say that we're optimizing for a better big O time complexity. That probably means that we need to use more space. And by using space, what I mean is we need to use a data structure. So think about a data structure that you can add, whether that be a hash map, or a graph, or a stack, or a queue, or a heap. Think about how those data structures could be used to speed up your program. And then similarly, if you wanna be efficient on space, that means that you're probably not gonna be using data structures, which means that you're gonna increase your cyclomatic complexity. There's probably gonna be more loops, in other words. Okay, the fifth step of the problem-solving process is to implement your solution. Obviously, it doesn't matter how well you understand the problem. It doesn't even matter how well you brainstorm. If you don't actually have code that you can submit, then it will all kind of be for nothing. And this should be the easiest part of the problem solving process. Everything that you've done to practice up to this point is about making sure that you can implement a good, clean, syntactically correct solution, right? You should probably be spending the least amount of time actually writing out code because you know where the curly braces go, you know how to use the data structures, you know how to use the functions in your given language. If you don't really know where the curly braces go, or if you don't understand, you know, the common functions or common ways of doing things in your given language, you're probably not ready to do a coding interview. I've expressed this opinion several times in previous articles and videos that I've done. I don't want you pseudo-coding in an interview. And the reason why I don't want you to do that is because in many situations, you have to produce real syntactically correct code in a given language. Pseudo-code isn't gonna work. So any code that you write for fake, you're gonna have to write for real. It's better for you to save wall clock time by writing code in the language that you're supposed to write it in and not in pseudocode. If you have to use pseudocode, fine. But in my view, you should practice well enough that you don't need to use pseudocode at all and can just turn your thoughts directly into code and then actually implement it. If you get stuck in the middle of implementing your code, one thing that I highly recommend is going back to an example and just, again, talking through and visualizing what you need to do in that example to transform that input into the required output. Now, also be careful, because you're gonna probably make mistakes, which is why the sixth step of the problem-solving process is to test your code. What I mean is that you should scan your code line by line and make sure that you don't have logic errors, that you don't have undeclared variables, that you don't have off by one issues. Now remember, because you have examples that you've come up with in step three, you should be able to use one or two of those examples to step through your code, turn your brain into a debugger, and make sure that the variables are updating the way that you expect it to. When I've had to do this for whiteboard coding, I would have like debugging watch variables on the whiteboard that I could update mentally to make sure that the code is doing what I needed to do. So turn your brain into a compiler and just make sure that number one, everything compiles, and that number two, you're progressing through the code the way that you need to for the given input. Make sure that you're also testing with exceptional conditions, maybe with bad input or with null or with zero or something like that. Now, although I believe using these steps are definitely going to help you do better in nearly any coding interview, it takes a while to get used to this. So anytime that you are practicing coding interview questions, whether on LeetCode, whether on HackerRank, whether you find them online, practice these six steps rigorously and regularly. When you start out at first, it's gonna be a little bit difficult. It takes some time to get used to it, but the more that you commit to this process, the better it will be for you. As I often tell people, these are my six steps until you make them your six steps. And the way that you do that is by practicing. Now, I want to hear from you. Did you find these six steps helpful? Are you going to use this as you are practicing problems going forward? Are there steps that you would add? Are there steps that you would break down? Do you have other problem-solving strategies that work well for you? Drop a comment, leave a like, and subscribe for more. In the meantime, I'm Anthony D. Mays. I'll catch you in the next video. Peace.